Taiwan was known as Formosa, beautiful island. Rich fishery culture is a natural treasure for the maritime people. Diligent fishermen, along with the strong promotion from the government, have made Taiwan to earn a prominent position in the world arena of fisheries as today. Please spare a moment as we witness the life of fish farmers and the story of how Taiwan's daring fishermen ventured across the boundless blue ocean.
My father's the captain of a fishing boat. He often reminds me that venturing from coastal and offshore waters to the world's oceans is the result of sweating hard work of Taiwan's fishermen. My father grew up in a fishing village, and fishermen of his generation have endless stories to tell about the sea. Surrounded by sea, the life of the people in Taiwan relied very much on the sea, and primitive fishing methods were used hundreds of years ago. A living testimony is the century-old stone weirs built in coastal waters. With only primitive fishing skills in the old days, fishermen could only operate in coastal and offshore waters. During the time of the Japanese occupation, the Japanese started building fishing boats and harbors and conducting extensive fishery surveys. At that time, the benefits from the fisheries development in Taiwan were all taken away by the Japanese. Taiwan's fishermen only learned the experience and techniques. During World War II, Taiwan's fishing boats and harbors were severely damaged. The only things left were some small motor-powered rafts and sampans. Everything had to start all over again. With only a few fishing boats around, villagers could often hear the blows from conch shell horns gathering people to pull up beach seines. It was just like a tug of war against the sea. Not only catching fish, it also fostered a special bond among fish folks. Fishermen of the older generation believed that boats meant their living had found something to rely on. After Taiwan's restoration, in cooperation with the government, people began to build fishing boats and harbors. Fishermen saw new hope. When a new boat set sail, it carried great expectations about the future. Eager to catch more fish, fishermen started to introduce new techniques while retaining some of the old ways left from the time of the Japanese. New techniques also brought big catches of mullet along its migratory route near Taiwan around the winter solstice. The older generation used to say, to live in a big house requires earning black gold. In those days, mullet enjoyed such a good price, it was almost a year-end bonus for fishermen. Because of the black color of the fish, it was called black gold. Mullet roe was then processed into a unique delicacy. With infrastructure gradually put in place, fishing boats of all sizes carrying their catches and fishermen working laboriously became a common scene in the brand new harbors. On the island from north to south, some unique fishing methods and all kinds of catches could be seen. Day and night, all year round, daring fishermen fought against the gusty waves, fishing for the livelihood of their family. The men went out fishing. Other members of the family, old and young, as well as women, also did their share to help make a living. After my father graduated from elementary school, he worked on a boat to help support the family. It was a destiny shared by boys in fishing villages. When the increase in the catch and fishing fleet for coastal and offshore fisheries was seen, the government's economic development plan began to focus on deep-sea fishery, aiming to earn more foreign exchange. Assistance was provided in the construction of large ocean-going vessels. With better-equipped vessels, fishermen could then sail to all oceans around the world. I remember my father told me Qianzhen Fishing Harbor of Kaohsiung was the most anticipated harbor to be seen by deep-sea fishermen, a symbol of home. After its completion, Qianzhen Fishing Harbor marked the emerging of Taiwan's deep-sea fishery as a remarkable figure in the world arena. To help fishermen enhance their expertise, training programs aiming at deep-sea fishing cadres and crew got underway. In the old days, deep-sea fishermen mostly came from offshore islands like Penghu and Liuzhou. They made this choice simply because life in their home villages was unbearably tough. My father was one of them. Gradually, the work on deep-sea fishing boats was joined by aboriginals from faraway mountains who also longed for a better life. Taiwan's deep-sea fisheries are just like those who have been pursuing a career away from home since their youth. Decades later, they have all won their success with fleets traversing oceans around the world. In the early stage of development, Taiwan's deep-sea fishery was mainly composed of trawlers. These catches carried back from different corners of the world also carry fishermen's longing for their homeland. Far away from home, fishermen were simply not there for some of the most important moments for their loved ones. 那时候太太已经怀孕了，然后三年多回来，那孩子已经四岁了，四岁的时候我太太帮我介绍给我女儿认识，然后她叫我爸爸，然后到十点多的时候吃完饭，我女儿竟然说，哎，妈妈，那个叫爸爸的人怎么还不回家？我们准备要睡觉了，所以我那时候倍感心酸。 In these stories mixed with sadness and happiness, Taiwan's tuna longline fishery prospered under the effort of the government and the industry, in the exploitation of fishing grounds and the building of large modern fishing boats. It has brought massive inflows of foreign exchange. Strong demand of Japanese sashimi market prompted a spree of building ultra-low temperature tuna longliners. Tuna catches are instantly frozen to very low temperatures to preserve their freshness. Today, one out of three slices of tuna sashimi consumed worldwide is supplied by Taiwan's tuna longline fleet. Big catches often come with big costs. Hard as it already is at sea, there are dangers everywhere. People of the older generation often said going out to sea means risking your life. So fishermen always pray for the protection of heaven. When I was little, I often followed my mother to the temple to pray for my father's safe return. Throughout the generations, fishing villages have developed different rituals for different festivals. But one thing remains unchanged, wishing for the safety of both seamen and boats. Squid used to be a rarity reserved for rituals and festivals. It was pricey and mostly imported. But thanks to the hard work of our deep sea fishermen, they are now an affordable delicacy. In just over a decade, Taiwan started from scratch and built the world's third largest squid jigging fleet, thanks to the exceptional diligence of our fishermen. Squid can be enjoyed by all at an affordable price. Upon returning to Taiwan in June, some squid jigging vessels will change gear and sail to the North Pacific to catch sori. To maximize their profits, fishermen toil in different parts of the world all year round. Taiwan's well-equipped purse seine fleet now forms a common sight on distant oceans. Whenever Dad returned with a big catch, Mom always took me to the harbor to meet him. After years of hard work, Dad luckily got promoted to captain. Our family's financial situation also improved gradually. Dad said many of his fellow fishermen started investing in fishing companies and became boat owners. They also started building new multi-story houses in their villages. Dad often said jokingly that wherever there's fish, there are fishing boats from Taiwan. Now Taiwan's fishermen can be seen on the world's three major oceans, delivering their catches to every corner of the world. An ambition began to form in my mind as I listened to my father's stories about earning a living at sea. Worldwide improvement in fishing technologies brought big catches, but also depleted fisheries resources. For deep sea fishery, now it's imperative for operators to comply with international conservation and management measures. Having surmounted many hardships, fishermen had to face an exceptionally formidable challenge in 2005. The international community reduced Taiwan's big eye tuna quota by 70%, alleging that our tuna longliners had engaged in massive illicit fishing. The government urgently recalled the large-scale longliners operating in the Atlantic and later scrapped 160 of them. The local fishing community suffered heavy losses. Under international pressure, the government started to implement the Deep Sea Fisheries Readjustment Plan. Starting from 2002, the observers program was expanded to a higher coverage. More observers were dispatched to conduct fisheries control and research. Now that I'm old enough, I've taken training courses for observers so that I could fulfill my dream. I also want to experience the life at sea that my dad had told me about. But my dad had just lost his job because of the boat reduction. He was quite upset about the regulations set by international organizations. I dared not tell him until a few days before reporting to duty. Even when I was about to leave home and report to duty, Dad didn't even say goodbye to me. Getting on board, many observers like myself would have to adapt to the life at sea and the loneliness of being far away from home. Having adapted to the life at sea, I started writing down how I felt because I wanted to share it with my father. Dad, is everything okay at home? I recall listening to your stories about life at sea when I was young. Now I can experience how hard it really is. I'm grateful for all you've done for our family all these years. I miss you all, and I promise to take good care of myself on board.
Hey,
Zunong,
hey,
I'm Louie.
Hey,
you know, Taiwan this year's fishing boat put out another one. You have to prepare
yourself. Yes.
Thanks to the overall readjustment and improved management, Taiwan won international recognition of its compliance with international measures and got its fisheries quota back the following year. Fishermen always set their eyes on distant waters. The global presence of Taiwan's fishing fleet and their interactions with various countries have given much impetus to Taiwan's flexible diplomacy. Many countries have come to know Taiwan better because of its fisheries. Only then did my father realize the efforts all sectors have been making. With experience from fisheries management of deep sea fisheries, the concept of resource conservation also took root in Taiwan's coastal and offshore fisheries. Environmental change combined with overfishing has led to a gradual decline in the fish caught in Taiwan's coastal and offshore waters. Step by step, various measures were taken to prevent depletion of coastal and offshore fisheries resources. These include limiting the number of fishing boats, a buyback program for decommissioning of older boats, and giving incentives to encourage fishing layoff. Gradually, we started to find fishermen thinking differently.
Because we can only get 7 months, so to 11月初到5月30日止。不过，咱的资源，伊的产卵期，咱无会加力，互伊继续试团，互伊继续试团。五个月以后，咱是毋着够资源能够力啊。
In recent years, people also began to regulate the catching of fish eggs and those fish with a low spawning rate. Control was also set over ecologically destructive fishing techniques, limiting total catch, the area and time of fishing, etc.
早期的渔民是不受管理。他们就随便去捕捞。近期这些渔民，他们真的有发现说，哎，这渔场上面的鱼的鱼资源真的有枯竭的迹象出现。那我们为什么不换个观念，好好保护这些资源，有限度的开发？因为我们现在都有做记录啦，每年产多少，然后哎，这个物种怎么样，从量去管控，有效的管理，你的资源绝对可以有效的运用。
Some say today's fishing is like keeping a bank account that generates interest, making withdrawals only when absolutely necessary. Only thus can it be sustained for many generations to come. Today's fishing villages are gradually changing gear to serve both tourism and recreation. Instead of catching fish, fishermen are now the best guides for fish watching.In turn, more and more people can now experience the culture unique to fishing villages while appreciating the beauty of the waters surrounding Taiwan. It's really another story of harmony between man and the ocean. A few months later, I came home safely after completing my mission. With mixed feelings of emotions and pride, I was eager to share them with my parents.
爸，隔几天啊，有一个表扬观察员的典礼，你甲阿母要斗阵来参加无？
我迄领真久无穿的西装，你甲提出来有一个，我要来参加哦，嘉禾的表扬典礼，爱穿较好个，会当让嘉禾落开。
After spending months on the sea myself.I finally realized all these fishing vessels carry not only fishermen's sadness and happiness, but also their expectations and hopes.
With focus shifted from catch to management, the combined efforts of government's policy guidance and fishermen's support have built a brand new image for Taiwan's fishing industry.With more restrictions in the use of fishery resources, the concept of sustainable production in aquaculture began to play an increasingly important role. In Taiwan, aquaculture did not begin until the restoration from the Japanese occupation. It's also a story of tiding over one fight after another.
On that day, I was joined by relatives and friends to celebrate my being cited as an exemplary fisherman. For me, the honor was not winning an award. Rather, I took the greatest pride in my father's broad smile. I didn't return home to join my father's fish farming until I grew up.Only then did I come to understand the hardships his generation had to endure. Fish ponds around Taiwan sustain numerous rural and fishing households. Hundreds of years ago, farmers had already begun harvesting oysters on Taiwan's western immense stretches of oyster farms along the shoreline.
When I was young, I was with my father, my mother, my father, and my father. I was with my father, 啊，一暝捡起来的时阵，用牛车啦，还是用担的，提转去厝的去破。细汉的时阵，诶，囡仔读册的时阵，爱先破一碗、两碗、三碗，才会使去读册。学校的学费啦、注册费，这些的费用都是靠这些。
In those days, fish fry could not be artificially bred yet, so people of the seaside villages could be seen braving the tides trying to catch fish fry. The fry of freshwater fish like grass carp and silver carp were first brought to Taiwan by Han Chinese settlers from the mainland. Importation was the only way because they couldn't be produced locally.
草鲢鱼那个时候啊，因为两岸啊吼没有来往嘛，所以一定要经过香港过来。那个时候鱼苗很贵啊，很迫切的要求要做人工繁殖嘛，很积极的抓母鱼做这个荷尔蒙打针，公的拿来精子一按下去，牛奶一样。一直搅拌，水冲下去，它瞬间就受精嘛。
The success in artificial breeding of grass carp and silver carp ended the centuries-old need for importing fry. It also inspired other technological breakthroughs. In the old days, people would keep counting when they fished for fry. This practice of counting was later put into rhyme, making a ballad passed down to our generation.Amidst this unique fry counting song, fish farmers have come up with meticulous care for fish that has fed many generations of Taiwanese. The milkfish, for instance, stands out as one of the most long-standing farmed fish.
以前的文献有讲，这个1661年荷兰管台湾的时，进前都将鱼温啊、饲杀来甲扣税金的资，迄这个资料。电信讲1662年就管台湾的事，对这个粮食的这个需求吼，就足迫切的需要，所以电信讲要部署，再过来推广杀来的粮食。
For many, the bony but delicious milkfish is an unforgettable delicacy. It was customary for people of fishing villages in southern Taiwan to have a bowl of steaming hot milkfish congee for breakfast.It filled the stomach and warmed the heart. The past decade saw Taiwan make several breakthroughs in the breeding of milkfish fry. The hatching of all these little ones was an instant hit across the global aquacultural research community.
1983年，自然产能成功，84年啊，这个杀来鱼仔量产技术，阮就建立起来。以前咱的鱼仔来源有困难，袂稳定，即摆用人工培养会当大量连续生产了。
There's quite a unique approach to harvesting the milkfish. People will deliberately scare the fish so that they excrete whatever is left in their stomachs. The process is called belly contraction. With improved breeding technologies, these leaping and rolling milkfish are now much more affordable to the public. When I was young, I often followed my father to the fish ponds. I also became interested in fish farming. Back then, fish farming had better income than crop farming, thanks to rapid technological enhancement. Many thus opted to convert their paddies to fish ponds.
When I was back at the river, my father would always throw my brother to the river. He said that the fish are not going to be able to do fish farming.啊！你若无补产后，你要倒提米来食，我阿讲哦，我惊无钱呀，我免惊无米呀。啊！伊怎啊配合着政府的政策，农渔牧经营，啊，水一直入一直出，鱼也真好大，迄阵做了袂歹，所以阮尾啊，刚开始规个拢总养乌龟鱼。
Tilapia has long been an indispensable part of the life in Taiwan's rural and fishing villages.My dad told me that its Chinese name, Wu Guo, is meant to commemorate two men, Wu Junhui and Guo Qijia.
吴先生跟郭先生哈、哦、被日本征调到南洋去当兵夫，日本战败把这些兵夫遣完，哎，吴先生跟郭先生哈、哦、偷偷的带回最原始的一个遗苗，那在台湾落地生根。
In those early years of shortages of everything, tilapia was a staple food for tens of thousands of Taiwanese. Fish farmers all loved to grow male fish because they were larger and grew faster. After many rounds of hybridization, now it's possible to cultivate all male fish. From an inexpensive fish to a high-grade gourmet choice,Taiwan's tilapia has now been given a new name.
This fish is called Taiwan Tilapia. It's 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 called Taiwan
Tilapia. It's called Taiwan Tilapia. It's called Taiwan Tilapia.第一条上外太空的鱼类哈，就是台湾鲷，哦，那我们现在在全球的一个品质上面是达到一个领先的一个地位。
Taiwan's economic takeoff fostered stronger demand for aquatic products and thus boosted aquaculture. A new miracle was forged as aquacultural exports began to expand rapidly.Winter is the time for catching eel fry in the coastal waters. The fully grown fish are one of the favorite fish for the Japanese. Eel used to be Taiwan's number one aquacultural export.
所谓的全盛时期就是说我们占日本市占率有65%，从鹿港以南的大家都在养鳗鱼，做风鳗鱼。从收入非常少的一个家庭里面，可以达到每个月、每年度、甚至收入1000万以上的很多。所以人家要说，哎，你在做什么行业啊？做鳗鱼，几乎大家都是开宾士的、BMW 的，都是啊，看起来就是哇，哦，你在做嘛？哦，你好雅人，大家都有这样子一个印象。
Another major foreign exchange earner was Taiwan's black tiger shrimp. Black tiger shrimp farming made many people rich.At that time, a lot of new multi-story houses appeared in fishing villages around Taiwan. People would jokingly call them black tiger shrimp houses. My family also prospered thanks to black tiger shrimp farming. But it took everybody by surprise that Taiwan's large-scale, highly intensive farming finally resulted in massive pathological changes.
你怎么赚的钱啊？这摆拢了了啊！啊，看以后是要安怎？
I planned to study aquaculture so I could join my father in fish farming, but the family's heavy loss drove my mother to stop me. So I left the fishing village where I'd grown up and tried my luck in the city.As black tiger shrimp got sick, many people suffered heavy losses. What's worse, aquaculture came under fire as the major cause of increasingly serious land subsidence along Taiwan's west coast. In response, the government adopted a new measure to help fish farmers create a new aquacultural environment by using seawater.
Because at that time, the price of the water was very high. Many people just used this opportunity, and then...有人就去养这个种类，那一个人重视的种类不一样，一下子就把这个台湾的海水就发展的相当多出来。
In the past, you could only catch mullet from the sea, but now this black gold can also be farmed with good quality.
潮水改变了哦，几乎咱的要抓在海里的乌已经真少了，一般的鲜贝哦，拢有演化的种类精神哦。多在饲的时阵，人嘛讲，哈，我那也会当饲乌鱼哦，因为乌鱼算乌金嘛。
There's an old saying that we have to eat mullet even if we wear no pants. It means pawning your pants is worthwhile for the sake of enjoying the delicious mullet. The female mullet can get a better price because they can provide eggs for making mullet roe. This incentive eventually inspired all female breeding technology. With government and industry working together, seawater aquaculture becomes the norm, more environment friendly, more economic return. Taiwan's aquaculture has also ushered in a new era of putting soil and water resources to more rational use. When I got older, I obeyed my mother and found a job in the city. One time when I went back to see them, I happened to hear them talking. At the sight of my miserable father, I remembered the days we spent at the fish ponds together. I realized that these ponds not only had fed our family, but also meant his lifetime's work. For his sake, I quit my job and joined my father at the fish ponds again. It didn't take long for me to discover that fish farming had already changed. For instance, many natural marine ranches began to make their way into Taiwan's vast coastal areas.
We have 30+ fish ponds. 主要海里是排排队的上大，伊的水质清气，会当养殖起来的品质会当较好安尼。像我养殖的都海，无在迄落对环境影响嘛。伫海，伊的唯一缺点就是风险较大。已经养过三次的天然灾害嘛。
Whenever a natural disaster strikes, timely assistance in the form of damage relief is always a force to inspire a fresh start. In addition to natural disasters, I noticed in many news reports there's a growing awareness of fish quality among the general public. When I tried to talk to my father about ways to improve our ways, strong objection was his response. Like me, many fish farmers are trying to keep up with the changing times and improve the quality of aquatic products. Aquatic products must first undergo processing in modern specialized plants, and then they must undergo various inspection and certification procedures to ensure their safety. People used to care about eating to fill their stomach, but now eating well is more important. Likewise, priority is now given to making aquatic products more refined, giving them added value. Besides placing greater emphasis on quality, farmers also began to grow fish of higher economic value. One instance is the grouper. In recent years, Taiwan has come to be known as the Kingdom of the Grouper.
啊，饲石斑上早吼，人工养殖，全世界嘛，咱台湾。
台湾目前哦，饲上多就是马拉斑啦，叫做青斑啦，这个量上多啦。啊，第二个就是龙胆石斑。台湾的养殖石斑鱼分工的非常好，受精卵出去到养成鱼的养殖场，每一段每一段都有它的专业，他们都有他们个人的技术，各个阶段都有啊专业的人才。台湾的优势就是在这边。
Thanks to a well-rounded work-sharing system, everybody was optimistic about the future.But a storm in 2009 virtually dashed the hopes of fish farmers. For all of us, the memory of that devastating typhoon will always remain an unforgettable nightmare.
重创是太严重，高经济价值的这鱼种全部拢流失了。造也造，死也死。文化放了了一年，两米外，干那要清洗只，就困难啊！佮加上财产鱼也捞了了，啊嘛无钱啊。
Under a sweeping reconstruction program, from sludge cleaning and low-interest loans to free aggregate for rebuilding fish ponds, Taiwan's grouper farming industry was fully restored in less than 2 years.Soon after the storm passed, live fish-carrying vessels could be seen busily loading their cargo at the harbors and getting ready to sail directly to China. It was a big boost to post-disaster reconstruction.
China has a big market, but the Taiwan fishing skills are good. And the fish are so much, and the basic market demand is just the amount of our production, maybe not every day. So the fishing boats are open.这个直航大陆以后啊，咱时间缩短一半，甲咱成本拢相对降低一半以上啊。规个养殖产业吼，会搁行搁较远，啊，搁一个新的境界。
One new live fish-carrying vessel after another is put to sea on course to China, carrying with them a load full of hope from the local fishermen.
来来来，来来来，放假你来来来。
阿爸，拄只渔会有通知，讲这边的模范渔民，我有得奖，爱去台湾领奖啊。
哦，有影无？健康你知影个哦。
哇，恭喜恭喜恭喜恭喜恭喜恭喜！
Despite everyone's congratulations, what I really cared about was my father's recognition. I also discovered that in the hands of the younger generation, Taiwan's fish farming industry has taken on a new look in recent years. Like precious stones in the water, ornamental fish are a case in point.
Taiwan 整体在观赏销售的国家大概是有二十几个国家的。研发大概在全世界也是数一数，因为我们台湾本来在水产养殖的技术就非常好，所以专业背景普遍都比国外的从业人员还高。像中型荧光鱼，基本上是台湾做的最先进。渐渐的，国际上也非常重视台湾这一块，也常常派人来台湾取景。观赏鱼它的水资源是比较不会用那么多，再就是因为观赏鱼它本身的单价比较高。政府这几年来也是很支持我们这个产业。
With its high economic value and using less soil and water resources, Taiwan's ornamental fish farming has also earned a place on the world stage.
我们有这个机会到德国去参加这个杜伊斯堡全世界最高的器材比赛殿堂，当时带了五条鱼去比赛，结果。拿了三支的分组冠军及一支全场总冠军的大奖，那奏着我们台湾的国歌，我们当时真的很感动。很多人在问你们是泰国吗？我说不是，我们是台湾。
When I got home from Taipei with my award a few days later, I saw the entire household bustling about. Not until then did I realize my father was so happy after all. But he didn't know how to express it. I was both touched and proud that my dedication didn't go unnoticed. Now it finally dawns on me that all these leaping fish are not only part of a long-standing heritage, they also embody the hope of every local family living on fish farming.
The marine footprint of Taiwan's fishing industry is full of struggling hardships. Government policy and infrastructure offer an indispensable catalyst, but the hard work of fishermen is equally important. Never self-complacent, Taiwan's fishing industry is committed not only to offering safe, quality aquatic products, but also to helping conserve marine resources. It is also set to take the helm in creating a unique marine culture that is worthy of a truly sea-loving country. Taiwan's fishing industry is now heading for its next century. It's also the beginning of its voyage to a new blue ocean.